Hello, everybody. I'm Rob Wallace here in St. Paul, Minnesota. I'm an evolutionary epidemiologist with the People's CDC, here with an update on the COVID-19 pandemic. This week, we'll cover the state of global COVID, the state of U.S. COVID, and the cognitive dissonance the American people are suffering between the Biden administration's declaration the pandemic is over and the continuing damage COVID-19 is imposing. We begin with global COVID. In the graph in red, the Johns Hopkins Coronavirus Resource Center reports a steady at 2.5 million new confirmed COVID cases worldwide for the week ending November 13th. The number of global weekly deaths, there in white, is slightly up to over 8,750 confirmed deaths this past week. In green, we see global vaccinations down to 14.6 million this past week. This New York Times map shows hotspots over the past week. Looks largely the same as a couple weeks ago. Greece, South Korea, Taiwan, and New Zealand remain in the top tier in average daily new cases per 100,000 population. The surge in Europe appears steady, with a slight increase in France and declines in Germany, Italy, and Finland. We see a decline in Russia and an increase in Australia. As we can see from these percent changes in caseloads the past couple weeks, rebounds there in the warm colors are still well distributed across the globe. We see new surges in the Western Hemisphere, including the U.S., but especially Peru, Cuba, Guyana, and Brazil. In Europe, Hungary, and Ukraine, suddenly China, also Indonesia and the aforementioned Australia, as well as in Africa, Morocco, Libya, Senegal, Guinea, Kenya, Madagascar, South Africa, and the Democratic Republic of the Congo, among other countries. At a time when most countries other than China have rolled back non-pharmaceutical interventions like mask mandates, clocking in at no more than 60% on the containment and health index measuring such interventions. With the US, Argentina, Russia, India, Indonesia, and a few other countries in South America, Europe, and Africa with no data reported this round. And at a time when the vaccine strategy many governments say they're pursuing instead of non-pharmaceutical interventions is failing. Much of the world is at best vaccinated for variants no longer circulating. We see uneven campaigns in booster vaccination across the world. On the one hand, Chile, Peru, Uruguay, Cuba, Canada, Belgium, Finland, Germany, Italy, and Japan show top-tier booster campaigns. In contrast, we see near nothing in Russia, India, Pakistan, Indonesia, and those even reporting in from Africa, as well as mediocre campaigns in the US, Mexico, Brazil, China, and Eastern Europe. The CDC reports the U.S. at a little more than 10% of its eligible population at five or more COVID vaccine shots. The collapse in vaccination campaigns, hand in hand with a rollback in the non-pharmaceutical campaigns that successful vaccination depends on, is occurring exactly when multiple Omicron subvariants are circulating across large expanses of the world. As of November 7th, we see in some of these countries subtyping their COVID samples, BA5 is falling back as BQ1 and XBB are coming on, with BA2.75 holding steady in a few places, especially India, but also France, the UK, the Netherlands, and Indonesia. The veritable zoo of new sublineages now circulating, the offspring of BA2, BA4, and BA5, continues to proliferate in a golden age of Omicron evolution. This week's new sublineages include BQ1.25, DE2, DF1, BF3.4, XBB1.5, CM8.1, and so on. Many of these sublineages are converging on the same molecular adaptations or combinations of new amino acid replacements. Those in the circles, some from different subvariant parents, have converged on molecular combinations that permit them resistance to monoclonal antibody treatments for COVID. Indeed, Prena Arora and colleagues show in a new short report published in Lancet Diseases that widespread sublineage BQ1.1 there on the far right is proving resistant to all commercial monoclonal antibodies, every single one. Other prevalent Omicron subvariants are shown to be resistant to almost all the treatments. That's particularly problematic for immunocompromised patients who do not mount a full adaptive response upon vaccination. The new sublineages aren't evolving just out from underneath our medicine, but also any population immunity we may have accumulated. Biologist Barak Rave reports an increase in reinfection rates of 20 to 35% with the emergence of BQ1.1 and XBB in Israel. More reinfections, more damage. As we reported on last month, a Washington University team showed that for all the long COVID or system level damage listed down on the left, all categories across vaccine status, none, partial, or fully vaccinated, have demonstrable increases in their hazard ratios with each new reinfection. That is, the more infections you get, the more likely you will suffer serious long-term illness. We need to ask, is this fine? Or, in meme talk, this is fine? This loop-de-loop in viral evolution that the world's leaders appear content heaping upon their constituencies? Turning to the U.S., this New York Times map shows almost the whole of the country is undergoing slight shifts in COVID cases per 100,000 population. The West Coast remains clearer for now. The Four Corners appears intensifying in its surge. The Plain States have returned to pinpricks of outbreaks, especially Western Kansas and the Dakotas. After many months, the Appalachian outbreak appears resolved, at least to the background of the rest of the country. The Northeast appears to be falling back in caseloads again. At the same time, four of the five New York City boroughs are registering as high on even the forgiving CDC measure of community levels. And by the transmission index, nearly the whole of the Northeast appears to host high levels of transmission. With hospitalizations for COVID at 30 or more patients per 100,000 people over many counties in the Northeast. More counties appear to be reporting in than was the case a couple weeks ago. That's good news. And there's another strange uptick in and around Charlotte, North Carolina, we reported on a month or so ago. Epidemiologist Elizabeth Wrigley Field reminds us that even in its ebbs, COVID-19 is always way deadlier than influenza, as shown in her example for our state of Minnesota. Other modes of tracking COVID-19 are patchy at best given uneven coverage. We see the levels of SARS-2 virus detected in the wastewater that comes through our sewage plants, a leading indicator of the pandemic, indicates much of the country in cooled off blues, including largely matching the drop in case loads along the West Coast. However, sewage plants in orange and red, representing SARS-2 loads of 60 to 100% more than previously recorded levels, are found across the Four Corners, Nebraska, less so in the Northeast, but especially in the upper Midwest, including Ohio, Wisconsin, and Michigan. However, the more acute measure of changes in sewage loads over the past 15 days show red flare-ups of 1,000% or more of SARS-2 detected across much of the country's sewage plants that are reporting in, including now up and down the West Coast, the upper Midwest, throughout New York State, down into New York City, and parts of the South. That might suggest an increase in cases in the coming weeks, even if many hospitals are following CDC's lead, with fewer of them reporting in. University of Missouri molecular virologist Mark Johnson recently presented on wastewater testing to the People's CDC. He gave us more background on the process and introduced us to the Sewer Shed Surveillance Project tracking trends in COVID wastewater load across Missouri, but also the different sublineages, well known and new, his team is detecting. Johnson answered many of our questions. We learned that his team tests repeatedly every 15 minutes for 24 hours, once a week for Missouri sewage plants. His team's PCR amplifies not just for presence, but the amount of SARS-2. The team is able to standardize their measure by the total people pooping. Here, by the amount of poop-altered caffeine molecule. They have been able to identify not only new variants, but the spread across the state, including the emergence of the Delta variant in 2021 as it moved town to town along the highway system. For the week for October 31st, it appears most places are hosting multiple variants. For instance, the Washington Wastewater Treatment Plant appears to have hosted B1.1.5, BA4, BA4.6, and BA5. Johnson reported that the SARS load is not associated with vaccine coverage across Missouri counties. He also reported that the relationship between SARS detected and COVID cases can change over time, with later outbreaks showing a decline in RNA detected given the COVID caseloads. That is, they saw less SARS-2 shed per case reported. That might mean shedding is subtype specific, but also perhaps as a consequence of both vaccination and immunity from natural infection. We'll add that it might also be a consequence of the reduction in case reporting. As the CDC abandons case reporting, wastewater testing, however uneven in its spatial distribution, may help fill in some of the resulting gaps. The People CDC recently posted a wastewater data fact sheet on its website, which we will link to in the video description. To sum up for now, here's the People CDC version of our present community transmission by county, mapped by our own Les Schaffer. It's the combo of caseloads and test positivity that the CDC plots, now reporting those data only once a week. But unlike the CDC, the People CDC differentiates the high level of danger counties are subjected to beyond 10% COVID positivity into high, very high, and extremely high exposure. Down at the bottom, we see that the People CDC also differentiates exposure by both the percent of counties and by the percent population. We see here that by population, we're down to 39% of the American people are in communities subjected to high to extremely high COVID exposure. That's still a lot, even if nowhere near the 90% of a couple months ago. And another 44% of the American people are subjected to substantial exposure. As in the Times map, we see the West Coast clearer, although bouncing back a bit, the Four Corners in a surge, and the Plain States hosting pinpricks up into the Dakotas. Unlike the Times map, the Northeast remains inundated in the way the South doesn't appear, although the Northeast does appear clearer than last week. The problem with such case-based mapping is that the states are following the NIH and CDC's lead and are increasingly abandoning COVID surveillance reporting. Tech analyst Gregory Travis reports more than half of U.S. states no longer regularly report COVID cases and deaths. Even with the albeit uneven retraction across the U.S., the outbreak stateside continues to evolve. We saw the shifts in its geographic patterns. We also see its continuing evolution, with the B5 and B4.6 variants being replaced by BQ1 and BQ1.1. BF7 appears steady. There's more out there in the U.S.'s evolutionary soup, however. Here's the 15-day trend of all the genetic sequences of detected sublineages in the U.S. as of November 17th, including, for some, their geographic centers. So there's lots of BQ1, BQ1.1, and XBB in New York City. BA5.1.6 is in Arizona, and BA5.2.1 is across the country from the West Coast to North Carolina. Two observations. First, now that XBB is in New York City, it's likely to blow back out to the rest of the country down through the hierarchy of cities by size and economics. Second, as in Missouri wastewater, we see many multiple subvariants and sublineages in the same locales, which might lead to the kinds of recombinants that the global chart of variants also detects. Even under the constraints of immune imprinting, there appears plenty of room for the virus to evolve at 2.5 million new infections a week worldwide. That's why driving SARS-2's population under its rate of replacement remains an important and entirely viable public health target. We end with a New York Times report in which reporter Ronnie Karen Rabin identifies a cognitive dissonance the country has been swept into. On the one hand, many Americans are acting as if the pandemic is over, while also worrying about the virus's continuing damage. Rachel Hoopsick, an Illinois community health professor, told Rabin that she teaches her largely unmasked public health students about the ways masking curbs infectious disease. The Time writes, "Life feels like an exercise in doublethink," Hoopsick said. Quote, "To participate in society right now," she said, "you have to either be blissfully unaware or to disassociate and carry on as if there isn't a pandemic," end quote. Although the Times does juxtapose this to President Biden's declaration that the pandemic is over, the newspaper didn't explicitly make the connection that people are taking the administration's lead on this. Rabin quotes the White House COVID response coordinator, Ashia Jha, that the two goals of returning back to normalcy and not letting the virus rule our lives are achievable as long as Americans keep getting vaccinated, test when necessary, and wear masks in crowded public settings, end quote. All campaigns the administration has largely abandoned. UC Santa Cruz social psychologist Elliot Aronson, quote, advises people who want to make more rational decisions to think about the thing they least want to think about, perhaps the more than 300 people still dying daily of COVID in the United States, but that many people who had a mild illness went on to develop long COVID, he told the Times. Rabin ties up the article that, quote, at the end of the day, different people will accept different levels of risk, end quote. Now, here at the People CDC, we view that position neither a matter of public health policy or governance. For there are proven interventions we as society can pursue to defeat COVID and buffer its damage. On the biomedical front, an Italian team just reported that long COVID patients with chronic fatigue and cognitive problems have impaired brain cortex GABA-B activity and reduced plasticity in the primary motor cortex. The team showed these can be restored with ultra-micronized palmitoyl ethanoamide, luteolin, or P-lute. P is a fatty acid amide and lipid modulator, and lute is a flavonoid. The team reported no funding conflicts. They're not being funded by pharmaceutical companies. And we see here the results of transcranial magnetic stimulation for long interval intracortical inhibition, the LICI, and short latency afferent inhibition, SAI, of the ulnar nerve somatosensory evoked potentials in the ultra-micronized P-lute and placebo patients. So that's a long way of saying that this intervention worked. And so the columns present the amplitude of motor evoked potentials as a percentage of mean unconditioned response in pre and post conditions. So those who got this P-lute had restoration in their brain cortex responses. And such drug development is ultimately successful if and only if our political leadership refuses to dismiss the millions hit by long COVID. Otherwise, the money dries up. And it's very important that our political leadership also refuses to continue to make millions more sick. Now, in a Harvard School of Public Health-led study, Tori Couger and colleagues showed masking, another intervention, works in schools. Here we see the percent cumulative difference in additional weekly COVID cases per 1,000 people for students and staff between greater Boston school districts that universally masked and districts that dropped the mask mandates. And we see the cumulative difference topping off at nearly 50 more new cases per 1,000 people in districts that ended compulsory masking. And the team also showed there was a greater impact on districts that had more Black and Latinx students and staff. So this is where the learning loss is happening. If you bring students back in, they don't mask, they get sick, they can't continue to go to school. So in that spirit, the People CDC just posted a new toolkit to help people plan safer in-person gatherings. And you can find it at cusafer.org, which we will also link in the video description. The toolkit includes this People CDC checklist of layers of protection to make your holiday, World Cup, or Super Bowl gatherings COVID safer. From setting your event outdoors, instituting universal masking, asking for pre-event testing, proof of vaccination, avoiding unmasked events beforehand, and so on. So, is letting COVID rip fine? No, it's not fine. And we have a responsibility and the capacity to act to roll back COVID, however much the political class getting us back to work in a continuing pandemic gaslights us otherwise. And that's COVID this week from the People CDC. You can learn more about the People CDC and read this week's COVID weather report at our website, peoplecdc.org.